Welcome to Boardroom Resources video series, a series that looks at important topics for CEOs, board members, general counsel, and corporate secretaries. And today we're at Northwestern University at the Kellogg School, and I'm TK Kerstetter, the CEO of Boardroom Resources and the host of Inside America's Boardrooms. And today we're going to talk about how market leaders manage critical company projects. My guests that are going to be joining me to help me cover this topic is Steve Wilson, the former CEO of CF Industries and a director with Ameren and GATX Corporations. Welcome, Steve.
Thank you.
And Tom Lebamoff, who's the managing partner with Liberty Advisor Group. Welcome, Tom.
Thank you, TK.
We had the benefit of creating an article for C-Suite Magazine. And we did a roundtable and talked about this topic of managing critical projects. And unfortunately, we're missing one of our people, Jenny Scanlon, who is with USG Corporation, had to be in China, so she couldn't join us for this part. But we do appreciate, and you can hear her or see her comments in the article. But Steve, in the article, we talked about managing critical projects, and they can either take a CEO and a company's sort of career and direction and shoot it upwards, or if mismanaged, it can start to put people in a hole. You've certainly had a lot of experience and were very successful at CF Industries. So can you give some insight into how hands-on you have to be? Obviously, the CEO needs to be able to delegate all the time, but at the same time, when you're managing a complex critical project for the organization, there is some touching that has to be done. Could you talk about that and maybe give an example of where you felt that these are things that are really important for me to keep my hands on?
Sure. I think the critical dimensions are really how important the particular undertaking is to the success of the company. Is it a project that could cause the failure of the company or put it in a highly vulnerable position? Is it a project that is critical to the success of the enterprise? And depending upon where you are on that spectrum, the more critical it is, the more the CEO needs to be involved. Obviously, the CEO cannot run the technical aspects of the project, but the CEO needs to have enough confidence in the sources of information coming to him to be able to make the right decisions. There will be forks in the road. There'll be decisions that have to be made. Those decisions need to be made on as much knowledge base as possible. So the CEO needs to get a feel for who in his organization is accountable, who's going to deliver the project, and where the points of vulnerability are on that project.
Yeah, I call that sort of being a pleasant skeptic as a CEO. You really, that the trustworthiness of that information coming up is really important, and I would think that that's sort of determines the trust that you have on how much time you have to spend on a particular project.
That's correct. And you know, an example that I would give you is we did a major acquisition. We're putting together our company with another company of comparable size. This was a combination that had to go smoothly. It was an integration process that absolutely had to happen. The day we opened the door as a single company, we needed to have enough of our information systems talking to each other to be able to look seamlessly as a new company. And to me, that's the epitome of an example of where the CEO has to be engaged and has to have his thumb on the pulse.
Yeah. When we sat in the round table, you had given us another example, a specific example, and this was a lot of large companies go through SAP installations, but you gave this as an example where, and what was unique about it is you actually hired consultants or advisors to oversee the consultants of the installation in the project. Now, immediately a lot of people would say, hey, that sounds like a waste of money, you know, and that, but the bottom line is the project was successful. It benefited the company significantly. So what lessons can executives learn that they might miss about what how you have to sometimes manage those projects.
Well, I have to confess, first of all, I was a chief skeptic about taking this particular approach. But an SAP installation is a highly visible project. There is, fortunately or unfortunately, a lot of history behind SAP installations in the business world. Some of that history is not very good. And so my board was very knowledgeable about past failures of SAP installations. So we wanted to make sure that we had the highest chance of success in an installation. This was a project that was critical to the infrastructure of the company. It was at the heart of our business. It was really a soup to nuts IT project. And so by having another set of eyes and ears looking over the shoulders of our management team, I had more confidence that I was getting the right messages back to me in order to fine-tune the direction we were going if that was necessary.
So Tom, you are the managing partner for a firm that specializes in four strategic areas. One of those areas is overseeing and managing complex project assignments, okay? So I assume you're not always asked to oversee other consultants, but can you share with us what model you use in the way of being so unique at being able to manage a complex task like that?
Yeah, it's really when you turn it 180 from a standpoint of this is about our client. It is about the company and not necessarily about our capabilities at Liberty. And what I mean by that, it's really about the culture of the company. How does decision making happen? Is it a top-down, center-led type organization, or is it very consensus-driven? And that's really the first thing to understand in large investments like an ERP or SAP project. Once you kind of have an understanding of that, this really becomes an experienced, seasoned team that we would provide to either be a force multiplier for our clients, especially when you look at companies may have never been through this before, or the management team has not been through this before, or the board for that matter. So you have to bring in expertise to minimize the risk to the business.
And do you find it a challenge, you know, all of a sudden there's a lot of consultants in the project, how do you sort of win over the staff? And even from your point, Steve, how do you make sure that everybody understands that this is a supplement to us to make sure that the information coming up is good? I'll let you start, Tom.
It's the giving the team the confidence. One of the, I think, important aspects is that you're leaving the company in a better place. So that capability that we've learned and have been burned before as individuals, we are essentially helping each person that we touch to strengthen and grow as both professional and even personal, because there's such a life work balance with programs like this that are multi-year, multi-function across an organization. So it's not just finance, it's not procurement, it's not manufacturing, it cuts across, and that's a very different process that most companies don't operate well across all those functions.
Steve, how about your view on that?
Well, picking up on what Tom had to say, a lot of it has to do with the effectiveness of the consultant in dealing in interpersonal situations. As a CEO, I would need someone who is able to dig into the organization in a way to get the facts to surface and bring them to me without being threatening to the in-house staff. And that takes a delicate balance between curiosity, probing, but also sensitivity to the ongoing structure of the organization and how it operates.
All that leads to the logical question of how things get started. And I wanted to talk to you guys about how the relationship starts. And I think a good way to do this is, I'm going to ask you both, obviously these scenarios have to be a good fit. So I'm sure there's questions that go back and forth that you both help to analyze whether it is a good fit. So Tom, I'm going to start with you, and I want you to share with us what foundational questions would you ask Steve that helps you determine whether this is an assignment that you guys would be good for? And then in return, Steve, I'll ask you what questions you would ask Tom for you to gain comfort that this is somebody that can deliver what I need delivered. Tom, I'll start with you.
So there's really four questions. One that we already discussed, which is around the culture and decision making. The second is this a top one or two priorities in the company? The third question really is, are you putting your best people on this project or program? And then the fourth question is around executive alignment. That could be either through compensation or an agreement, you know, micro agreements between each other that, since it is a cross-functional program, that everyone is there to support each other. So those are really the four areas that we focus on.
Steve, what do you use?
And going back in the other direction, I would really focus on two areas. The first is, what is the actual process that you go through in order to decide what is the truth? What is the information that should come to me as the CEO? And what is the information that is just noise or is just, you know, bickering among staff? Because they have boots on the ground, the consultant does, and should have the ability to sort all of those things out. The other question that I would be very curious about is, describe for me a failure. You know, when you had an assignment like our assignment, what one of those went wrong, and why did it go wrong, and what have you done to address those kinds of issues going forward? Because there's no perfect project, there's no perfect process. We should all be tuning our process based on experience, and I'd be interested to know how the evolution has occurred since a problem arose.
Well, those sound like good questions from both sides, and in six quick questions, there's a lot of information in that that's going to give you a feel for how I'm sure each other's expectations are relative to going forward. So we want to close this. We always want to pass along great information to whoever happens to be viewing our videos. But the last question that I would pose to both of you is, in managing a critical project like this, from both your perspective as a public company, Steve, and yours as a consultant, Tom, what one piece of advice would you offer your colleagues that are watching out there on how to ensure that this project goes well?
It's pretty clear to me that the critical aspect is fixing accountability. Who's in charge of delivering the project? What does that person have at stake in the project? For example, it's important, I believe, for the accountable person to be in a position to have to live with the result. So for me, it's simple. What's the point of accountability?
Executive alignment. Without executive alignment, you won't be able to deliver a quality value project that you started on in a enterprise type function that cuts across every area and most likely every leader in the company.
Well, Steve, Tom, I can't thank you enough for joining us. That will conclude this edition of our Boardroom Resources video series. We hope you enjoyed the show. We will be back again with another critical topic that'll help you be a better executive or board member. So we'll see you then.